Good evening, and welcome to this all Bach concert, live streamed to you from the mighty Flentrop organ in the gallery of St. Mark's Cathedral in Seattle. I'm very glad you're with us. In 1972, the New England Journal of Medicine published an article by Lewis Thomas about the first international conference on communication with extraterrestrial intelligence. In this article, Dr. Thomas wrote, "Perhaps the safest thing to do at the outset, if technology permits, is to send music. This language may be the best we have for explaining what we are like to others in space, with the least ambiguity. I would vote for Bach, all of Bach, streamed out into space over and over again. We would be bragging, of course, but it is surely excusable to put the best possible face on at the beginning of such an acquaintance. We can tell the harder truths later. Tonight, I will play three of Bach's famous Toccatas and Fugues for organ, and then I'll round out the program with his beloved Passacaglia in C minor. Let's hear first Bach's famous Toccata and Fugue in D minor. So, how about this organ? This is the famous Flentrop organ, so named for its builder, the Flentrop organ building firm based just outside Amsterdam in Holland. This organ was custom built for St. Mark's Cathedral by the Flentrop firm in the early 1960s. It was shipped to Seattle via the Panama Canal, unloaded here in the port of Seattle, brought to St. Mark's, erected, voiced, and tuned over a period of months, and then dedicated to the glory of God in September of 1965. It has nearly 4,000 pipes. They are cast into five divisions. Each division is controlled by a separate keyboard. So we have the top keyboard, the third one, the second, the first, and the pedal board is effectively the fifth keyboard. Each of those five divisions has its own set of stops. The top keyboard has stops controlled by the knobs that I'm pointing to now. The third keyboard by these knobs. The second keyboard by these knobs. The bottom keyboard by these knobs. And then the bottommost knobs on both sides are for the stops played by the feet on the pedal board. There are two basic kinds of organ pipes. There are flues and reeds. The flues are essentially penny whistles, and the pipes that you see in the facade of the organ case are this kind of pipe. It's the lion's share of the pipe work in the organ. At least two-thirds of the pipes are flues. And they range in size from 32 feet, which you can see at the outer extremes of the organ case, to just a couple of inches. The tiniest pipes are above the organist's head in the so-called Brustwerk division. The flue pipes love to sound in choruses made up of several pitches. And much of Bach's music that I'm playing tonight sounds really well on flue choruses. So I'm going to demonstrate how to build one of those choruses up. I'll hold one note and then draw individual stops on the second keyboard to achieve a noble chorus. The other family of stops, the reeds, are kind of like a clarinet. There's a reed that vibrates, sending a tube into vibrations which speak at a certain pitch and volume and so and timbre. The reeds in tonight's program are especially featured in the pedal passages, most notably in the pedal solo of the very next piece I'm going to play. So let me build up for you the pedal reed chorus, starting from the top and going down. So I'm going to start with a 2-foot reed, then the 4-foot reed, the 8-foot, the 16, and finally the 32-foot reed, one of those stops for which organists live. It's a very exciting sound. The most notable reeds on this organ are arguably right above my head, sticking out horizontally from the case. They are the trumpets en chamade. I won't be using them in tonight's program. I don't think they're that well suited to the music I'm playing tonight, but you deserve to hear them. So here's a little fanfare on the trumpet pointing out horizontally above my head. Definitely appropriate for those high holy days that we love to celebrate in the church. About the action of the organ. And by that I mean the connection from keys to where the pipes are. In the 20th century, organ builders began to make that connection electrical, so that the key was essentially an on-off switch. But in the time of Bach, before electricity was born, the connection was mechanical. And that's how this organ is built. Even though it's a 20th century creation, it is built in those time-honored manners that were very much how organs were built even before Bach. So there's an intricate linkage, a mechanical linkage from each key to the chests where the pipes are. And it's kind of like the mechanical linkage between your piano key and the hammers that hit the strings. It's intricate, carefully balanced, and relatively lightweight. You'll notice as I play this evening that some keys will appear to go down on their own. No, there are no ghosts playing with me. Instead, I'm using couplers. The couplers are a mechanical device inside the organ here that link keyboard to keyboard or keyboard to pedal board, so that a certain sonority you have on the third keyboard, let's say, if you want to blend that sonority with what you have set up on the second keyboard, you can couple them together. And it's done by simply pulling the right knob. Here's the knob for 2 + 3. Watch what happens on the third keyboard. And you'll see that happen as I play the pedals too. The music of Bach is all about balance, symmetry, and pleasing proportions. You can bet that anything he wants the right hand to play, the left hand will eventually play. And anything that the hands play, the feet will eventually play. All the voices get a turn. This is one of the reasons why choirs love to sing Bach. This balance is exquisitely demonstrated in the toccata that I'm going to play now. Bach seems to say, look what I can do with my hands, and then look what I can do with my feet, and then look what I can do with my hands and my feet together. Isn't this fun? The fugue that goes with this toccata in C major is one of Bach's most buoyant, lighthearted, and playful. It would be splendid in the hands of a skilled group of bluegrass fiddlers. Wedged between this toccata and fugue is an adagio. Adagio, as you know, is Italian for at your leisure. So it's the name we give to a slow movement in a multi-movement work. And it's a beautiful lyrical movement of repose between two rather frenzied movements in C major. The toccata, adagio, and fugue in C. Thank you.
Thank you.
I told you it was playful. So, let's move on to the Toccata and Fugue in F major. This one opens with a canon in which the right hand leads and the left hand follows two measures later. Just as in the last Toccata, what the hands have played, the feet must play. And so Bach gives them an energetic solo. Then the same cycle is repeated, now in the dominant key of C major. This time the left hand leads and the right hand follows in the canon, and then the pedals have their solo. All of this flows into a toccata of perpetual motion that goes through just about all the keys, major and minor, before finally returning to F major. And it's quite a journey. It's one of the most joyful expressions of energy I can imagine. So, as you've noticed, all of tonight's compositions end with a fugue. And just to review, a fugue is a musical form in which a subject, that is a musical tune, is introduced by one voice, taken up in turn by at least three additional voices, then tossed back and forth in a kind of animated conversation among all the voices. But this fugue in F major is especially masterful because it's a double fugue. Here's the first subject. And here's the second subject. Each subject is developed into its own conversation in turn, but at the end of the fugue, Bach combines them into a kind of a double conversation. And I'll give you the two subjects combined. It's ingenious in two voices. Wait till you hear it in four, with a lot of organ stops on. The Toccata and Fugue in F by Bach. Thank you. What a flood of sound. I'm having so much fun. I hope you are too. I want to take a moment to thank the handful of people who are hiding in various corners of this building, helping make this happen tonight. David Wagner is our facilities manager who made the lights happen. Roger Sherman is here as our sound engineer. The inestimable Christopher Brown is our videographer this evening, and St. Mark's Director of Communications, Gregory Block, is masterminding this production, and I'm just so grateful to all of them for helping make this happen. A Passacaglia is a series of continuous variations played over a repeating melodic bass line. Here is the melody on which Bach's Passacaglia is based. It's his own creation. Over the course of 20 variations, that melody migrates from the pedals to the voices played by the hands and back to the pedals. These variations then spill into a climactic fugue whose subject is drawn from the first half of that melody. Here's the first half again. So what about the second half of the melody? Is it wasted? Of course not. It becomes the fugue's countersubject. So here's the second half of the melody, and I'll show you how it morphs into the countersubject. Within that are three key notes. They become this countersubject. And so together with the fugue subject, based on the first half of the Passacaglia theme, the two sound together like this. Pretty amazing stuff. I think this is one of the reasons why mathematicians and architects and philosophers and engineers and physicians and theologians love Bach's music as much as musicians do. In this music, nothing is wasted and nothing is wanting. The Passacaglia in C minor. Thank you. on behalf of our dean, the very Reverend Steve Thomason, and all of us here at St. Mark's Cathedral in Seattle, thank you for joining us this evening. God bless you, and God give you a wonderful night.